we're going to be talking about how soon Great Britain might have to be demoted to decent Britain. I mean, someone who compliments himself in their country's name? Even North Korea kept it humble. Although Democratic People's Republic of Korea? Yeah, okay. Hey, Kim beat political prisoner 128 by 200% of the vote. Now, years ago, the United Kingdom voted to leave the European Union because it was 2016 and we were voting to do all sorts of crazy things back then. They set a distant deadline for March 29th, 2019 because surely they'll have an agreement by then. Well, 2.5 years went by and they might be even further from an agreement now than in 2016. In this episode, I'm going to go over what newspapers are predicting tomorrow will be a humiliating parliamentary defeat for the United Kingdom's Prime Minister, for now, Theresa May. And I wouldn't get too attached. And the effects of the now likely no-deal Brexit on the United Kingdom. So first, where are we?
We now have 5 more days of all-out Brexit in Parliament here. The Prime Minister will rat next Tuesday and then the vote. And if she fails, May just has a few weeks to come back to Parliament and outline her plan B.
That was reported 5 days ago. And what do you know, tomorrow's Tuesday, the day of the general parliamentary vote. There are a few problems that has everybody united in hating this deal. Most notably that this deal's biggest achievement would be separating Britain from having votes on EU regulation while still having to be regulated by that regulation. Until it can be negotiated in a few years. Which, with this government's track record, that might creep up pretty quickly. It's basically like me telling my parents I don't want to live under their rules anymore, and them responding, well, if you want to live under this roof, you're going to have to. Okay, can I at least go to bed at 10:30 on weekends? You said you didn't want to be involved in this parental system anymore. You don't get to make the rules. So conservatives who want to leave the European Union are not happy with any of this because, again,
they're unhappy about elements of the deal which they say could see the UK trapped into taking the rules of the EU but without any voice in their making.
Yeah, I played that clip because what I was saying sounded like such an unbelievably bad best outcome, you might need a British accented newsman to believe it. So the goal is regulation without representation. People who want to stay in the EU must be happy because, hey, at least we're still under uniform codes, right? No, because it's still leaving, so you don't get membership benefits anymore, even if you have to endure the costs. Lastly, this would probably impact the border between Northern Ireland, which is Brexiting, and OG Ireland, which is staying in the EU. Because it's a stalemate government debate in 2019, there's got to be at least one border involved. When EU's Ireland and the UK's Northern Ireland are governed by the same rules and essentially the same organization, there's no problem. It would be like the border between California and Oregon. But you start making laws governing the two areas different and the countries different, and you find yourself not quite at a US-Mexico border, but we're definitely talking a US-Canada border. Build a customs center. At this point, it's pretty clear to see why this thing isn't very popular amongst any group. An inevitably split up Ireland, losing EU perks, and still having your rules governed by the EU. No deal Brexiting isn't sounding so bad anymore, huh? We'll get to that in a second. But why not renegotiate with the EU, who has already agreed to this deal Parliament will be voting on tomorrow? Well,
now, the EU has emphatically said throughout this week, despite all the drama going on here, that we're not opening up the negotiations again, because if we do open them up, it's not just what you want that will be discussed. We'll be talking Gibraltar, we'll be talking fisheries, we'll be talking everything again, and we don't want to do that. We've gone through the past couple of years of negotiations, and the time is now ticking away.
Not only the logistical challenges of opening up this debate again, but going to the UK to ask for more negotiations would be like dumping your girlfriend and then calling her a month later to ask for that video game you bought together. But you really think you would enjoy it more, so you should have it. The United Kingdom is not leaving on the best of terms with the European Union, and the European Union wants other countries that may consider leaving a moment of hesitation before they it'll leave. That's right, Italy Five Star Coalition, I have a pun in my back pocket for when you guys decide to pull the trigger. So you may be asking, with such a bad best case scenario, what is a no deal Brexit? Well, Theresa May is currently going on a fear tour by going to a Stoke factory and, well, stoking some flames. Man, what a metaphor! You walked right into that one.
Others in the House of Commons take a different view and regard no deal as the ultimate threat to be avoided at all costs. To those people I say this. The only ways to guarantee we do not leave without a deal are to abandon Brexit, betraying the vote of the British people, or to leave with a deal. And the only deal on the table is the one MPs will vote on tomorrow night.
So how catastrophic is no deal? I mean, if it's worse than that deal, that's pretty alarming. Well, we'll focus on the following three areas: trade, people, and money. First, trade. This is a big one because all of Great Britain's trade agreements were made through the EU. So if all of a sudden they leave, they're gonna have no trade deals with anybody. Your trade rules will revert back to WTO rules, and you're gonna be starting from scratch. That might sound not that bad, but for example, the US has a free trade agreement with the EU. But we don't have a free trade agreement with Britain, because that's redundant. That would be like Mexico saying, we've got a free trade agreement with the United States, and another free trade agreement with Montana. This would immediately trigger EU and US tariffs on UK exports, as well as tariffs of every other country. And if 2018 has taught us anything, it's that trade agreements not exactly easy to make right now, especially from scratch.
Broadly, that means leaving the EU in March 2019 without the kind of comprehensive free trade agreement the government says it wants. But even that isn't clear-cut. People happy for us to leave without a deal concede we might need some basic agreements to keep planes flying, say, or to stop a meltdown in financial contracts.
Basically, when the clock strikes midnight March 29th, the UK as an independent UK will have to hit the ground running. Theoretically, this could just be a Y2K situation. Oh man, computers are gonna rise up because they can't handle changing the date from 1999 to 2000. But in something that's never a good sign.
The government is sticking to its line that a deal with Europe is still the preferred option. But in the last few days, ministers have admitted they're also planning to stockpile critical supplies like medicines and food in the event of a no deal and the chaos that would ensue.
Stockpiling medicine and food? That's the least reassuring thing I've heard. This is because on all imports from anywhere, British tariffs are going to be imposed. Because, again, no trade deals. This means everything's going to get a lot more expensive. Theresa May has to be looking across the pond at Donald Trump as well and thinking, can't we just push this thing to 2020? The next big problem is Brits abroad, because if you study history, you know that the British won't be confined to their little island. There are millions of Britons living across the world and millions of Europeans living in Britain. And all of a sudden, this is an EU visa you're living under. Yeah, you're gonna need to go back to Britain and get a British visa, or vice versa. The final piece people are watching is money. And good news? While Britain wouldn't be receiving $3 billion in farm subsidies, they wouldn't be obligated to pay $13 billion in dues to the EU. So hey, you can spend all that savings on a wall separating the islands. I hear that doesn't cost much more than $5 billion. Again, each individual piece might not sound world-ending, but this is death by a thousand cuts. Like...
Brexit wouldn't just mean severing trade links. Some fear Britain could leave the European police agency Europol and lose vital intelligence at a time of international terrorism.
European health insurance cards don't work in Britain, and neither do British driver's licenses in Europe. Just think, everything that can go wrong will go wrong, all at once, and you have to pick up the pieces. So in the coming days and weeks, we're going to see Britain finalize exit plans to either take the deal, which will keep EU restrictions on the UK without the UK's input, eventually split up Ireland, and have the UK lose all EU perks while giving them years to negotiate new contracts, or we'll see them just set fire to every bridge and figure it out. Or as some have suggested, they might go against the will of the people and re-enter. Man, does this really put a government shutdown and stagnation over a friggin' wall into perspective. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.